Merchant, Wikipedia article audio. A merchant is a person who trades in commodities produced by other people. A merchant historically was anyone who was involved in business as long as industry, commerce, and trade have existed. The status of the merchant has varied during different periods of history and among different societies. In modern times, the term occasionally has been used to refer to a business person or someone undertaking activities for the purpose of generating profit, cash flow, sales, and revenue utilizing a combination of human, financial, intellectual and physical capital with a view to fueling economic development and growth. Etymology and usage. Types of merchant. History. Merchants in antiquity. Merchants in the medieval period. Merchants in the modern era. In art. In architecture. And sources. Merchants have been known for as long as humans have engaged in trade and commerce. Merchants and merchant networks were known to operate in ancient Babylonia and Assyria, China, Egypt, Greece, India, Persia, Phoenicia, and Rome. During the European medieval period, a rapid expansion in trade and commerce led to the rise of a wealthy and powerful merchant class. The European Age of Discovery opened up new trading routes and gave European consumers access to a much broader range of goods. From the 1600s, goods began to travel much further distances as they found their way into geographically dispersed marketplaces. Following the opening Asia and the discovery of the New World, goods were imported from very long distances. Calico cloth from India, porcelain, silk, and tea from China, spices from India and Southeast Asia, and tobacco, sugar, rum, and coffee from the New World. By the 18th century, a new type of manufacturer merchant was emerging and modern business practices were becoming evident. The English term, merchant, comes from the Middle English, marchant, which itself originated from the vulgar Latin mercatant or mercatans, formed from present participle of mercatar meaning to trade, to traffic or to deal in. The term is used to refer to any type of reseller, but can also be used with a specific qualifier to suggest a person who deals in a given characteristic such as speed merchant to refer to someone who enjoys fast driving, a noise merchant, used to refer to a group of musical performers. Other known uses of the term include, dream merchant used to describe someone who peddles idealistic visionary scenarios, and merchant of war to describe proponents of war. Elizabeth Honig has argued that concepts relating to the role of a merchant began to change in the mid-16th century. The Dutch term, koopman, became rather more fluid during the 16th century when Antwerp was the most global market town in Europe. Two different terms, for a merchant, began to be used. Meesters referred to local merchants including bakers, grocers, sellers of dairy products and stall holders, while the alternate term, koopman, was used to describe those who traded in goods or credit on a large scale. This distinction was necessary to separate the daily trade that the general population understood from the rising ranks of traders who took up their places on a world stage and were seen as quite distant from everyday experience. Broadly, merchants can be classified into two categories. However, the term merchant is often used in a variety of specialized contexts such as in merchant banker, merchant navy, or merchant services. Merchants have existed as long as business, trade, and commerce have been conducted. A merchant class characterized many pre-modern societies. Open-air, public markets, where merchants and traders congregated, were known in ancient Babylonia and Assyria, China, Egypt, Greece, India, Persia, Phoenicia, and Rome. These markets typically occupied a place in the town's center. Surrounding the market, skilled artisans, such as metal workers and leather workers, occupied premises in alleyways that led to the open marketplace. These artisans may have sold wares directly from their premises, but also prepared goods for sale on market days. In ancient Greece, markets operated within the agora, and in ancient Rome, the forum. Rome had two forums, the Forum Romanum and Trajan's Forum. The latter was a vast expanse, comprising multiple buildings with shops on four levels. The Roman Forum was arguably the earliest example of a permanent retail shop front. In antiquity, exchange involved direct selling through permanent or semi-permanent retail premises such as stallholders at marketplaces or shopkeepers selling from their own premises or through door-to-door direct sales via merchants or peddlers. The nature of direct selling centered around transactional exchange, where the goods were on open display, allowing buyers to evaluate quality directly through visual inspection. Relationships between merchant and consumer were minimal, often playing into public concerns about the quality of produce. The Phoenicians were well known amongst contemporaries as traders in purple, a reference to their monopoly over the purple dye extracted from the murex shell. The Phoenicians plied their ships across the Mediterranean, becoming a major trading power by the 9th century BCE. Phoenician merchant traders imported and exported wood, textiles, glass, and produce such as wine, oil, dried fruit and nuts. Their trading skills necessitated a network of colonies along the Mediterranean coast, stretching from modern-day Crete through to Tangiers and onto Sardinia. The Phoenicians not only traded in tangible goods, but were also instrumental in transporting the trappings of culture. The Phoenicians' extensive trade networks necessitated considerable bookkeeping and correspondence. In around 1500 BCE, the Phoenicians developed a phonetic alphabet which was much easier to learn than the pictographic scripts used in ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia. Phoenician traders and merchants were largely responsible for spreading their alphabet around the region. Phoenician inscriptions have been found in archaeological sites at a number of former Phoenician cities and colonies around the Mediterranean, such as Byblos and Carthage in North Africa. The social status of the merchant class varied across cultures, ranging from high status to low status, as in China, Greece, and Roman cultures, owing to the presumed distastefulness of profiting from mere trade rather than from labor or the labor of others, as in agriculture and craftsmanship. The Romans defined merchants or traders in a very narrow sense. Merchants were those who bought and sold goods, while landowners who sold their own produce were not considered to be merchants. Being a landowner was a respectable occupation. On the other hand, the trade of merchant was not considered respectable. In the ancient cities of the Middle East, where the bazaar was the city's focal point and heartbeat, merchants who worked in bazaar were considered to be among the high-ranking members of the society. Medieval attitudes toward merchants in the West were strongly influenced by criticism of their activities by the Christian Church, which closely associated their activities with the sin of usury. In Greco-Roman society, merchants typically did not have high social status, though they may have enjoyed great wealth. Umbrisius Scoras, for example, was a manufacturer and trader of fish sauce in Pompeii, circa 35 CE. His villa, situated in one of the wealthier districts of Pompeii, was very large and ornately decorated in a show of substantial personal wealth. Mosaic patterns in the floor of his atrium were decorated with images of amphora bearing his personal brand and bearing quality claims. One of the inscriptions on the mosaic amphora reads GFSCO/SCORI/XOFFI/NASCAU/RI, which translates as the flower of garum, made of the mackerel, a product of Scorus, from the shop of Scorus. The reputation of Scorus fish sauce was known to be of very high quality across the Mediterranean, and its reputation traveled as far away as modern southern France. Other notable Roman merchants include Marcus Julius Alexander, Sergius Orida, and Annius Plocamus. In the Roman world, local merchants served the needs of the wealthier landowners. While the local peasantry, who were generally poor, relied on open-air marketplaces to buy and sell produce and wares, major producers such as the great estates were sufficiently attractive for merchants to call directly at their farm gates. The very wealthy landowners managed their own distribution, which may have involved exporting. Markets were also important centers of social life, and merchants helped to spread news and gossip. The nature of export markets in antiquity is well documented in ancient sources and archaeological case studies. Both Greek and Roman merchants engaged in long-distance trade. A Chinese text records that a Roman merchant named Luan reached southern China in 226 CE. Roman objects, dating from the period 27 BCE to 37 CE, have been excavated in sites as far afield as the Kishan and Indus ports. The Romans sold purple and yellow dyes, brass and iron, and acquired incense, balsam, expensive liquid myrrh and spices from the Near East and India, fine silk from China, and fine white marble destined for the Roman wholesale market from Arabia. For Roman consumers, the purchase of goods from the East was a symbol of social prestige. Medieval England and Europe witnessed a rapid expansion in trade and the rise of a wealthy and powerful merchant class. Blintiff has investigated the early medieval networks of market towns and suggests that by the 12th century there was an upsurge in the number of market towns and the emergence of merchant circuits as traders bulked up surpluses from smaller regional, different day markets and resold them at the larger centralized market towns. Peddlers or itinerant merchants filled any gaps in the distribution system. From the 11th century, the Crusades helped to open up new trade routes in the Near East, while the adventurer and merchant, Marco Polo, stimulated interest in the Far East in the 12th and 13th centuries. Medieval merchants began to trade in exotic goods imported from distant shores, including spices, wine, food, furs, fine cloth, notably silk, glass, jewelry, and many other luxury goods. Market towns began to spread across the landscape during the medieval period. Merchant guilds began to form during the medieval period. A fraternity formed by the merchants of Tiel in Gelderland in 1020 is believed to be the first example of a guild. The term guild was first used for Gilda Mercatoria to describe a body of merchants operating out of St. Omer, France in the 11th century, and London's Hansa was formed in the 12th century. These guilds controlled the way that trade was to be conducted and codified rules governing the conditions of trade. Rules established by merchant guilds were often incorporated into the charters granted to market towns. In the early 12th century, a confederation of merchant guilds formed out the German cities of Lübeck and Hamburg, known as the Hanseatic League, came to dominate trade around the Baltic Sea. By the 13th and 14th centuries, merchant guilds had sufficient resources to have erected guild halls in many major market towns. During the 13th century, European businesses became more permanent and were able to maintain sedentary merchants and a system of agents. Merchants specialized in financing, organization, and transport, while agents were domiciled overseas and acted on behalf of a principal. These arrangements first appeared on the route from Italy to the Levant, but by the end of the 13th century, merchant colonies could be found from Paris, London, Bruges, Seville, Barcelona, and Montpellier. Over time, these partnerships became more commonplace and led to the development of large trading companies. These developments also triggered innovations such as double-entry bookkeeping, commercial accountancy, international banking including access to lines of credit, marine insurance, and commercial courier services. These developments are sometimes known as the Commercial Revolution. Luca Clerici has made a detailed study of Vicenza's food market during the 16th century. He found that there were many different types of merchants operating out of the markets. For example, in the dairy trade, cheese and butter was sold by the members of two craft guilds and that of the so-called resellers, and by other sellers who were not enrolled in any guild. Cheesemongers' shops were situated at the town hall and were very lucrative. Resellers and direct sellers increased the number of sellers, thus increasing competition, to the benefit of consumers. Direct sellers, who brought produce from the surrounding countryside, sold their wares through the central marketplace and priced their goods at considerably lower rates than cheesemongers. From 1300 through to the 1800s, a large number of European chartered and merchant companies were established to exploit international trading opportunities. The Company of Merchant Adventurers of London, chartered in 1407, controlled most of the fine cloth imports, while the Hanseatic League controlled most of the trade in the Baltic Sea. A detailed study of European trade between the 13th and 15th century demonstrates that the European Age of Discovery acted as a major driver of change. In 1600, goods traveled relatively short distances, grain 5-10 miles, cattle 40-70 miles, wool and woolen cloth 20-40 miles. However, in the years following the opening up of Asia and the discovery of the New World, goods were imported from very long distances: calico cloth from India, porcelain, silk, and tea from China, spices from India and Southeast Asia, and tobacco, sugar, rum, and coffee from the New World. In Mesoamerica, a tiered system of traders developed independently. The local markets, where people purchased their daily needs, were known as tianguis, while pochteca was the term used to describe long-distance, professional merchants, traders who obtained rare goods and luxury items desired by the nobility. This trading system supported various levels of pochteca, from very high-status merchants through to minor traders who acted as a type of peddler to fill in gaps in the distribution system. The Spanish conquerors commented on the impressive nature of the local and regional markets in the 15th century. The Mexica market of Tlatelolco was the largest in all the Americas and said to be superior to those in Europe. The modern era is generally understood to refer to a period that coincides with the rise of consumer culture in 17th and 18th century Europe. As standards of living improved in the 17th century, consumers from a broad range of social backgrounds began to purchase goods that were in excess of basic necessities. An emergent middle class or bourgeoisie stimulated demand for luxury goods, and the act of shopping came to be seen as a pleasurable pastime or form of entertainment. As Britain embarked on colonial expansion, Large commercial organizations were much in need of sophisticated information about trading conditions in foreign lands. Daniel Defoe, a London merchant, published information on trade and economic resources of England, Scotland, and India. Defoe was a prolific pamphleteer, and among his many publications are titles devoted to trade, including Trade of Britain Stated, 1707, Trade of Scotland with France, 1713, The Trade to India Critically and Calmly Considered, 1720, and A Plan of the English Commerce, 1731, all pamphlets that were highly popular with contemporary merchants and business houses. 18th century merchants, who traded in foreign markets, developed a network of relationships which crossed national boundaries, religious affiliations, family ties, and gender. The historian, Van Nest, has argued that a new cosmopolitan merchant mentality based on trust, reciprocity, and a culture of communal support developed and helped to unify the early modern world. Given that these cosmopolitan merchants were embedded within their societies and participated in the highest level of exchange, they transferred a more outward-looking mindset and system of values to their commercial exchange transactions, and also helped to disseminate a more global awareness to broader society, and therefore acted as agents of change for local society. Successful, open-minded cosmopolitan merchants began to acquire a more esteemed social position with the political elites. They were often sought as advisors for high-level political agents. By the 18th century, a new type of manufacturer merchant was emerging, and modern business practices were becoming evident. Many merchants held showcases of goods in their private homes for the benefit of wealthier clients. Samuel Pepys, for example, writing in 1660, describes being invited to the home of a retailer to view a wooden jack. McKendrick, Brewer, and Plum found extensive evidence of 18th century English entrepreneurs and merchants using modern marketing techniques, including product differentiation, sales promotion, and loss leader pricing. English industrialists, Josiah Wedgwood and Matthew Boulton, are often portrayed as pioneers of modern mass marketing methods. Wedgwood was known to have used marketing techniques such as direct mail, traveling salesmen, and catalogs in the 18th century. Wedgwood also carried out serious investigations into the fixed and variable costs of production and recognized that increased production would lead to lower unit costs. He also inferred that selling at lower prices would lead to higher demand and recognized the value of achieving scale economies in production. By cutting costs and lowering prices, Wedgwood was able to generate higher overall profits. Similarly, one of Wedgwood's contemporaries, Matthew Boulton, pioneered early mass production techniques and product differentiation at his Soho manufactory in the 1760s. He also practiced planned obsolescence and understood the importance of celebrity marketing, that is, supplying the nobility, often at prices below cost, and of obtaining royal patronage, for the sake of the publicity and kudos generated. Both Wedgwood and Boulton staged expansive showcases of their wares in their private residences or in rented halls. 18th century American merchants, who had been operating as importers and exporters, began to specialize in either wholesale or retail roles. They tended not to specialize in particular types of merchandise, often trading as general merchants, selling a diverse range of product types. These merchants were concentrated in the larger cities. They often provided high levels of credit financing for retail transactions. Elizabeth Honig has argued that artists, especially the Dutch painters of Antwerp, developed a fascination with merchants from the mid-16th century. At this time, the economy was undergoing profound changes. Capitalism emerged as the dominant social organization, replacing earlier modes of production. Merchants were importing produce from afar, grain from the Baltic, textiles from England, wine from Germany, and metals from various countries. Antwerp was the center of this new commercial world. The public began to distinguish between two types of merchant: the meesters, which referred to local merchants including bakers, grocers, sellers of dairy products and stallholders, and the koopman, which described a new, emergent class of trader who dealt in goods or credit on a large scale. With the rise of a European merchant class, this distinction was necessary to separate the daily trade that the general population understood from the rising ranks of traders who operated on a world stage and were seen as quite distant from everyday experience. The wealthier merchants also had the means to commission artworks, with the result that individual merchants and their families became important subject matter for artists. Paintings of groups of merchants, notably officers of the merchant guilds, also became subject matter for artists and documented the rise of important mercantile organizations. A Jewish Merchant and His Family by Paolo Uccello, 1465-1469. The Arnolfini portrait, believed to be of Italian merchant, Giovanni di Nicolò Arnolfini with his wife, by Jan van Eyck, c. 1434. Lorenzo de' Medici, merchant, Florentine bust, 14th or 15th century. Matthias Mulick, merchant in L. Beck, by Jacob Claes van Utrecht, c. 1522. Portrait of Anton Fugger by Hans Mahler Zita Schwaz, c. 1525. A wholesale merchant operates in the chain between the producer and retail merchant, typically dealing in large quantities of goods. In other words, a wholesaler does not sell directly to end users. Some wholesale merchants only organize the movement of goods rather than move the goods themselves. A retail merchant or retailer sells merchandise to end users or consumers, usually in small quantities. A shopkeeper is a retail merchant. Portrait of George Giz, the merchant, by Hans Holbein the Younger, c. 1532. Portrait of a member of the Wei Dai merchant family by Hans Holbein the Younger, c. 1532. The Hansa Attic merchant, Syracus Kale, by Hans Holbein the Younger, c. 1533. A Hansa Attic merchant, by Hans Holbein the Younger, c. 1538. Portrait of a merchant by Cornet de Lion, c. 1541. Sir Thomas Gresham by Anthonys Moore, c. 1560. Cornelis van der Geest, merchant of Antwerp, by Anthony van Dyck, c. 1620. Portrait of Nicolaes van der Borgt, merchant of Antwerp, by Van Dyck, 1625. 35. Portrait of the cloth merchant, Abraham Delcourt and his wife Maria de Kierskieter, by Bartelmoes van der Helst, c. 1654. Frederick Rijhel, a merchant on horseback by Rembrandt, c. 1663. Portrait of Amsterdam merchant, Cornelis Nuts by J. Regen Evans. Portrait of Joshua van Bell, merchant in Spain by Bartolom Esteban Murillo, c. 1670. Portrait of Peter Knoll, senior merchant of Batavia, With Family, by Jacob Jans Coeman, c.1655. The Merchant by Abraham van Strijd, c.1800. Caspar Vaught, German Merchant, 1801, by Jean Laurent Meissner. Joshua Watson, English Wine Merchant, 1863. The Carpet Merchant by Jean L. Onge R. Me, c. 1887. Merchant Setoff by Anonymous, mid-19th century. Governors of the Wine Merchants Guild by Ferdinand Ball, c. 1680. The Syndics of the Drapers Guild by Rembrandt, c. 1662. Four Officers of the Amsterdam Coopers and Wine Rackers Guild by Gerbrandjens van den Eekhout, c. 1660. Reception of Jan Carol de Cortes at the Guild Hall by Balthasar van den Bossche, c. 1711. Although merchant halls were known in antiquity, they fell into disuse and were not reinvented until Europe's medieval period. During the 12th century, powerful guilds which controlled the way that trade was conducted were established and were often incorporated into the charters granted to market towns. By the 13th and 14th centuries, merchant guilds had acquired sufficient resources to erect guild halls in many major market towns. Many buildings have retained the names derived from their former use as the home or place of business of merchants. The Merchant's House, Kirkcaldy, Scotland. Merchant Tower, Kentucky, USA. Medieval Merchant's House, Southampton, England. Tudor Merchant's Hall, Southampton, England. Draper's Hall, Coventry, England. The Blacksmith's Guild Hall, Venice, Italy. Shoemaker's Guild Hall, Venice, Italy. Broadhouse, Baker's Guild, Einbeck, Germany. Nockenhauer Ramtschos, Butcher's Guild Hall, Hildesheim, Germany. The Butcher's Hall, Antwerp, Belgium. The Hanseatic League Building, Antwerp, 16th century.